do it if you ask him, but you gotta say it out of your own mouth. Say it, say it.
Step down.
You to do it. Here's why. We need to see a sign. We need to see a wonder.
Good morning, everybody. Could you all stand and join in with me for prayer, praise, and worship? For this is the day that the Lord has made, so we should rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's just lift up our hands to the Lord and just worship him and give him honor for just allowing us just to be in this place another Sunday, just being able to give his name honor and glory. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we just come to you, God, just to say thank you, God. We thank you for the blessings of this day, God. We thank you for life, health, and strength, God. We thank you for just being God and God all by yourself. God, we thank you just for allowing us just to be able to travel here safely, God, this morning. God, we don't know what everybody had going on this morning, God, but we thank you just for allowing us to press our way to this place, God. God, right now we pray for your glory just to rain on us and settle here right in this place, God. God, we just thank you, God. We thank you for your anointing, God. We pray for a brand new fresh anointing, God. God, a brand new fresh anointing, God. That anointing that destroys yokes, God, that lifts burdens, God, that allows us to see signs and wonders, God. That's what we want right now, God, and we thank you for it right now in the name of Jesus, God. God, I lift each and every person up to you in this place, God. God, I lift up those who are worshiping with us virtually, God. God, I lift up our leaders to you right now in the name of Jesus. God, I ask that you keep your hand on them, God. Keep their mind fresh, and God, keep the hunger for wanting to do more for your kingdom, God, right now, so strong, right now in the name of Jesus, God. God, I just ask that you touch the sick, God, those who are sick physically, mentally, spiritually, God, just touch them and heal them right now in the name of Jesus. All these things we ask in your darling son Jesus' name. Amen. Lord, purify our hearts, Lord. Sanctify our hearts, Lord. Sanctify our hearts, Lord. Lift your hands and worship this morning. Purify our hearts, Lord. Sanctify. Sanctify our hearts, Lord. Come on, say it again. Sanctify. Sanctify our hearts, Lord. Oh, Lord, we need the Lord this morning. We need to see you. Oh God, yeah, we're desperate for you. Now let your glory settle here. Right here, let it settle. We're going right now. Hallelujah. Oh God. Come on. Come on and take your seat. I burdens at your feet. With you we can't be beat. Won't you settle? You can settle. To see your wonder, oh God, yeah, one more time, settle down.
Give God some praise. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. My brothers and my sisters, it is so good to see each and every one of you this Lord's Day morning. Our announcements are going to begin flashing on the screens. I want to encourage you to govern yourselves accordingly. I look forward to seeing you this week in Bible study. We've been having an awesome time in the Lord, and I would encourage you to make your pressure way to God's house. Also, my brothers and my sisters, don't forget about all the other announcements of the day and of the week. And my brothers and sisters, we prepare. I ask that you would mark your calendars for March the 6th. March the 6th begins the Lenten season, and we will begin with our Ash Wednesday service, and we will begin sharing in our Lenten fast. We'll roll all that information out in the days and the weeks ahead. And so Lent will begin on March 6th and end on March the 20th, because the third Sunday in April is Resurrection Sunday, and we are praying now as we count down to Calvary. My brothers and sisters, let me get everyone to stand, everybody to stand all over the house. Go find somebody you didn't speak to yet this morning. Hug them real tight. Look them in the eye and tell them God loves you, and so do I. Go find somebody all the way on the other side of the church. Hug them. Tell them God loves you, and so do I. Thank you. Amen. We want to celebrate all of the birthdays in the month of February. Come on, let's praise God for all of the February birthdays in the house. My brothers and sisters, as the ushers come, it's offering time. My brothers and sisters, we ask that you would, if you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. The ushers would be glad to give you one. As you know, there are several ways that you can give to the Lord's house. You can give via offering envelope. You can give on our website, theit.org. You can also give through our church app, The Emmanuel Temple, and you can give through Cash App, $ The Emmanuel Temple. For those who are worshiping virtually, I would encourage you to be a blessing and sow into this ministry. This is fertile soil. I am grateful for all of the persons who've already given recurringly, and I want to encourage everyone to begin and become a recurring giver, which means every time you get paid, you can automatically deduct it from, it will automatically hit your debit card, your credit card, and you can give as the Lord has blessed you to give 10% of your income and watch God do the miraculous and the marvelous in your life. So whatever you're going to give today, come on, let's put it in our right hand. Let's lift it up to the Lord. You know what I'm going to say? If the day is not your day, praise God that Friday is coming. Gracious, wonderful, kind God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, God, for the wonderful privilege to give back to a God, God who has given so much to us. Now, God, accept these, our gifts, tithes, and offerings as our tangible expressions of our trust, you, in our trust in you, God. God, we give, God, because we want to see your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. We give, God, because we want to eradicate poverty, God. We give, God, because we want to be a blessing to those who are in need, God. We give, God, because we want to be like you, and you gave first, and you gave your best gift, and that was your Son, Jesus the Christ. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. And all those who love the Lord said amen. And we know that God loves a, God loves a, God loves a. Everybody, won't you stand, face the outside walls, won't you come down and place your gifts of tithes and offerings in these baskets. Song simply says, tragedies are a commonplace. All type of diseases and people are slipping away. The economy is down and you can't get a break. But as for me, all I can say is thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. And do I have anybody else in the house and worshiping virtually who just want to say thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for me? Because we know it could have been us. Outdoors with no food and no clothes, now, just a number and a tragic end. But you didn't let anything these things be, because by your power you keep on keeping me. I just want to just say thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. The band's gonna keep playing that right now. I want you to just meditate right there on that moment right there. Just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you. brothers and sisters, several of our members have lost loved ones. We ask that you would keep them lifted in prayer. Sister Marvelline Hannibal lost a brother. We ask that you would keep that family lifted in prayer. Sister Gwendolyn Jones lost a brother-in-law. All of those persons were funeralized yesterday. We ask that you would keep that family lifted, those families lifted in prayer. Sister Karen Norwood and Sister Tangela Griffin lost a first cousin who was like a sister. And we ask that you would keep that family lifted in prayer. Sister Minerva Green was funeralized yesterday in Orlando. My brothers and my sisters, we still have members who are still out of work. We still have members who are going through some times of trials and tribulations. We still have members who are dealing with challenges in their family life. And we ask that you would keep them lifted in prayer. And so my brothers and sisters, Sister Tiffany is going to bless us now with God's word through dance. And I'm going to ask that right where you are, won't you whisper a word of prayer? Pray for those who sit to the left and to the right of you and in front and in back of you. Pray for those who worship virtually with us each and every Sunday as they feel God's presence and God's power.
Lord, on this new day, we thank you and give you praise. And as we bring our cares and concerns before you, O God, we just say, Lord, we love you. Have your way. Lord, we trust you. Have your way. Lord, we stand on your promises. Have your way. Lord, every circumstance, situation, we bring to you and we say, have your way. And we can do that right now, O God, because we know that your way is always, your property is always to have mercy. We know, O God, that we are your beloved children, and when we bring our stuff to you, we bring our issues to you, when we bring our very selves before you, God, you know just how to love on us. You know just how to fix us. You know just how to transform us. You know just how to call us out of those things that have held us down and to take us higher into the things of you. You know just how to fix us and make us right. You know how to let your anointing flow afresh and anew. And God, we recognize, Lord, that when we come before you and bring our stuff before you, Lord, you've also told us to not just think about ourselves, God, but to bring others and the circumstances and situations that others are going through, to bring that to you too. So we stand right now, oh God, in intercession, Lord, and we ask that you would bless those whose names are on our hearts, God. Bless those whose names are in our minds, God. Bless those who need a blessing and a fresh touch from you, oh God, because they need your healing right now in the name of Jesus, because they need deliverance right now in the name of Jesus, because they need a do-over right now in the name of Jesus, because they need a chance after the last chance right now in the name of Jesus. Do it, God, as only you can do it in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we declare and decree that yokes are destroyed in the name of Jesus. We declare and decree that there's healing in the house in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, marriages are mended and set on fire once again in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, single folk are seeking first your kingdom and your righteousness and allowing you, oh God, to bring all that other stuff to them in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we are free. In the name of Jesus, we are free. In the name of Jesus, the devil has no authority. We are free indeed in the name of Jesus. And right now, God, as we come to this preaching moment, have your way. Have your way. Preach, Holy Spirit. Preach, Holy Spirit. Preach, Holy Spirit. We need a word from you right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And let all those who love the Lord just shout amen. Come on, won't you stand and share with me? Hallelujah to the name of Jesus. Won't you share with me? As we journey to the very first gospel, the gospel of Matthew, and we're going to gather, take out your phones and come on with me to the fifth chapter, verses 43 through 45a from the New International Reader's Version. Listen now for the word of the Lord. You have heard it was said, love your neighbor, hate your enemy. But here is what I tell you, love your enemies, pray for those who hurt you. Then, somebody shout then you will be children of your Father who is in heaven. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let us all shout, thanks be to God. As you take your seats, I want to tag this text before us, no hate. Come on, share with your neighbor. Neighbor, oh neighbor, no hate. Now we are about more than halfway through Black History Month, and I want to give God praise for this kingdom movement. Pastor and I have been homiletically highlighting love so far this month. We've been preaching about love, y'all. And I want to thank God that in this place that we call the Emmanuel Temple, we may not always get it right one-on-one, But when we gather together, both here in the sanctuary and virtually, as a body of believers, love is in our midst. And if you don't know, you better ask somebody. Because when we gather here under the blood-stained banner of Jesus, as disciples of the Christ and under the designation and proclamation of Emmanuel, we are declaring before the world and all the witnesses seen and unseen that God is with us. And since God is with us, that means love is in our midst because God is love. And I know we don't always get it right. We don't always get it right. We individually and collectively, from the pastor to the co-pastor to the ministerial staff to the servant leaders to the members, even the visitors, we don't always get it right. Yeah. We sin by omission, and we sin by commission, and we sin by submission. We don't always get it right. We sin by thought. We sin by word. We sin by deed against God's divine majesty, provoking most justly God's wrath and indignation against us. We do not always get it right. We earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, because we do not always get it right. At least once a month, and if you're honest, we need to do it every minute of every hour. We need to cry out, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, because we do not always get it right. We don't always speak right. We don't always act right. We don't always look right. You know, we can give crazy looks sometimes. We do not always get it right. And that's because we all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But what I love about this kingdom movement is, what I love about being a part of the Emmanuel Temple is, that by our very name, we are reminded that we aren't here because we get it right all the time. By our very name, we are reminded that we need a Savior, and we aren't here because we speak right all the time, and we aren't here because we dress right all the time, and we aren't here because we act right all the time. We are here because this is the Emmanuel Temple, and this kingdom movement is here because God put us here. God is with us. God will never leave us. God will never forsake us, and God is not through with us yet. Yet, hallelujah, yet we are new creatures in Christ Jesus, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. So early on in establishing this kingdom movement, we set forth a vision and a mission. And we knew we were disciples, which means learners from Jesus. And we're apprentices of Jesus. And we're here to grow and learn and grow. And along the way to learning and growing in the likeness of Jesus, we knew that we wouldn't always get it right. But we also knew that there was one thing we could commit to help us stay on track and provide a safe space, a sacred place right here as for all of us. And we knew that we had to put at least one thing in place to protect the atmosphere for growth in the house, and that was the no hating rule. And I just want to remind us this morning that the no hating rule is still in effect at the Emmanuel Temple. Everybody's family got house rules. Am I right about it? We family, right? We family, right? Every family got house rules, and we family, right? And so I just want to remind us that in this house, the no hating is a house rule. We family, right? We family? No hating, right? We ain't gonna hate on Kenya because she's a real vocalist. And we, like my mama used to say, can't carry a tune in a lead-lined bucket. Somebody ought to shout no hates. We ain't gonna hate on Sister Angie because she got curls this morning and she got that serving the kingdom piece on lock, and we haven't even joined a ministry yet. Somebody ought to shout no hate. We ain't gonna hate on Pastor White because he got that fine bald head and because God has given him a vision for the house, a radical hospitality and imaginative LOL, love out loud, and we can't even yet see ourselves to giving our tithes and our offerings consistently. Somebody ought to shout no hate. I don't care who you are, if you've been here, and if you're using your gifts, and you're walking in the anointing and serving the kingdom of God to his glory, we ain't gonna hate on you, because house rule says there's no hate. Somebody shouted no hate. In our text, Jesus lets us know we're on the right track with the no hating rule. But on this journey of faith we call life, we cannot stop at no hating. Yeah. Check your phones, pull out your Bibles. In verse 43, we see Jesus use a word that's translated there in the English as neighbor, but it's a word that really means relatives. Jesus is teaching that as kingdom people, as his disciples, we have to go beyond loving our relatives, our kinfolk. Mm-hmm. And y'all know how we do. We may fight with them. Come on now. Maybe it's just my family. We may fight with them. We may curse them out. We may fight like cats and dogs, but let somebody else say something. Let somebody else say or do something crazy with our people, with our family. Could have just been fighting with them a minute ago, but you try to mess with them and see what happens. We all of a sudden get that Tiffany Haddish spirit. We ready, and we will fight you. But keep your phones open, because in verse 44, Jesus says the love he's talking about, it's not just about relatives. Jesus says we've got to not only love them, we've got to love our enemies too. Just close your eyes for a minute. Whether you're here in the sanctuary or worshiping virtually, close your eyes for just one moment. Who is your enemy? Who do you have still that chip on your shoulder about? Whose guts you can't stand? Okay, keep your eyes closed. Who's the one always aggravating you? Who's the one that always got something to say, always dogging you out, always doing you wrong? Reverend. Now open your eyes. Tell your neighbor. Jesus says, love that one. Reverend. Come on. Jesus says, love that one. And before you write that off, I want to remind us that once upon a time when we were colored, back in Montgomery, Alabama, at the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther the King Jr. preached this very text. And he got all up in his congregation's face when he told them, we cannot dismiss, Pastor. This passage is just another example of biblical hyperbole, just a sort of exaggeration to get over the point. This is a basic philosophy of all that we hear coming from the lips of our very master, because Jesus wasn't playing. Jesus was serious. He said, not only love your neighbor, love your enemy. In other words, when Jesus said, love your enemies, pray for those who hurt you, Jesus meant exactly what he said. No, Jesus wasn't dreaming. No, Jesus did not stutter. Jesus actually and really and definitely wants us to love the lynch mob members.
He wants us to love the killer cops. He wants us to love the ones who can sit in a Bible study and then murder the attendees. Jesus wants us to love the wannabe cop who shoots down a child in a hoodie and walks away scot-free. Jesus wants us to love the hate-mongering, misogynist, crazy orange president sitting in the White House. Jesus wants us to love the ones who personally attacked us, molested us, betrayed us, bombed us, lynched us, and abandoned us. Jesus wasn't playing, because he laid down his life for all people, for all people, for all people. And we as his disciples must recognize that when he did that for all of us, and he gave us this text, that's his no hate rule. Because Jesus says for his disciples to truly live love, we've got to share it. We've got to share it, love, and even share it with the unlovable. And just like that, y'all, just like that, like he always does, Jesus radically reverses what comes natural to us. Some of y'all looking at me right now, like, I know Jesus said it, but Reb, we can't do that. Yes, we can. We need to just recognize that Jesus radically reverses what comes natural to us and what's taught us by the world. Jesus redefines the way his disciples love. Are there any of his disciples in the house? Because he redefines this thing called love, turning the concept completely upside down. And why does he do it? Because Jesus knows how we are in our natural, worldly, fleshly selves. We want it our way. Later on, y'all, Jesus' brother James breaks it down in the first chapter of his epistle called James, when he writes these words: what causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desire to battle within you? You want what you want, what you don't have, and so you scheme and sometimes kill to get it. You are jealous of what others have, but you can't get, so you fight and you wage war to take it away from them. Yet you don't have what you want because you don't ask God for it. And even when you do ask God for it, you don't get it because your motives are all wrong. You only want it for your pleasure. And just like that, violence begets violence. It's the same principle, and Martin Luther King Jr. taught nonviolence, putting Jesus' words to use to bring the kingdom power of justice right here on earth. When King taught, hate begats hate. Violence begats violence. Toughness begats a greater toughness. We must meet the forces of hate with the power of love. But how? How are we supposed to do that? We do it, first of all, because it's our inheritance. Come on, check your phone. Get back in the scripture. It's right there in verse 45. Jesus proclaims, then you will be children of your Father who is in heaven. We have to remember who we are. At the point that Jesus is teaching and preaching in this scripture, love your enemy, Jesus is sharing his Sermon on the Mount. And it's a sermon full of vivid examples of what it looks like in God's kingdom, what life transformed by grace really looks like, what life in union with God and as God's children and in living within the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, when we live together with them, what life really looks like. Jesus is teaching us who we are in him. So the first thing that has to happen in loving your enemies is that you gotta know who you are in Christ. You need to know who you are in Christ Jesus so you can live your life as God intended. The more you agree with God about your identity in Christ, the more your behavior will begin to reflect your God-given identity. God only one that counts. Am I right about it? So when we accept what God says about us and agree with God that who we are in Christ is really true, we become the spiritual person, the one full of God's grace, God's supernatural power to truly, truly be who God says we are. And that's the point. We are who God says we are, not who they say we are. King told the folk at Dexter that day, and I want to repeat it in here today. Now I'm aware of the fact that some people will not like you, not because of something you've done to them, just because of who you are. They just won't like you. I'm quite aware of that. Some people aren't gonna like the way you walk. Some people aren't gonna like the way you talk. Some people aren't gonna like you because you can do your job better than they can do theirs. Some people aren't gonna like you because other people like you. Some people aren't gonna like you because you're popular, because you're well-liked, and they're not liked like you're liked. Some people aren't gonna like you because your hair is a little bit shorter than theirs, or because your hair is a little bit longer than theirs, or because your skin is a little bit brighter than theirs, or because your skin is a little bit darker than theirs. And they aren't going to like you because your skin is thick, because we're still here after all that they've done to us. Some people aren't gonna like you. They're gonna dislike you, not because of something that you've done to them, but because of various jealous reactions and other reactions that are prevalent in human nature. But tell your neighbor, in other words, haters gonna hate. But the word of God says, if people give you a report that is contrary to the word of God, let God be true and everybody else be a liar. Do you know who you are, IT? Do you know who you are worshiping virtually? Because you've got to know who you are in order to truly be who you are. God's word says, if you are in Christ Jesus, you are loved. You are an accepted child of God, Jesus' friend, a joint heir with Jesus, sharing in his inheritance with him. God won't hold nothing back to us who are in Christ Jesus, because we're united with God and in one spirit with him. We are the temple of his Holy Spirit, the holy and living God, whose spirit and whose life is in us, in Christ Jesus. You're a member of his body, a saint, a chosen one of God, holy and dearly loved, and you've been given exceedingly great and precious promises by God himself, which God will share with you in his nature. And God works in us to help us do the things he's called us to do. In other words, when the giver of every good and perfect gift gave you the gift of salvation, you already received the supernatural power of God's grace to be exactly who God says you are and to do exactly what God calls you to do. Tell your neighbor, you've got to know who you are and whose you are. I'm about through. You know, on a collective level, as a community,
in these yet to be United States, and under the tyranny of the Klansmen in chief, we better recognize things are not getting worse. Things are being uncovered that were always there. From the orange peel in Washington to the redneck round the corner, things are being uncovered that have always been there. And in order for us to keep going from going completely cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs, with all the shenanigans and all the foolishness, all the oppression and all the injustice going on right now, we gotta know who we are and whose we are. That's the only way we can love this kind of love. That's the way to know hate. This love is not a sentimental something that we talk about. It's not merely an emotional something. This love that Jesus intends and commands is creative, Pastor. It's understanding goodwill for all humanity. It's the refusal to defeat any individual per se, because when you rise to this level of love, it's a great beauty and a power, and you seek only to defeat the evil systems underneath all the oppression. Individuals who happen to be caught up in that system, you love them, but you seek to defeat the system. That's why we need to already be registering and getting ready to vote again. We need to defeat the system. This love, this agape defeats systems and offers hope for people who are oppressed by those systems, and also offers hope for those who are the oppressors perpetrating the system. And when we rise to this level of love, we begin to love people not because they're likable, but because God loves them. You look at every person and you love them because you know God loves them, even though they might be the worst people you've ever seen. Come on, y'all, let's be real. Let's be real. Love your enemy. That's what Jesus says, but he didn't say like your enemy. Like seeks to attach to something sentimental. It's affectionate. But if you know like I know, there are a lot of people who you just ain't gonna like. Hallelujah, somebody. There are a lot of people we don't like because of what they do or did to us. Don't like what they said or say about us or our people. Don't like their attitudes. There's just something about them we don't like. But can we just be real in the house this morning? There's a whole lot of people we can say without a doubt and without a hesitation, we don't like them. But Jesus says, love them even if you don't like them. And pray for those who hurt you. He says, pray for those who hurt you too, because we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark and fallen world, and against spirits in high and heavenly places. And this love is greater than like. This love says, love those people, because love is greater than like. And pray for those people, especially for the ones you don't like, because the weapons of our warfare are not merely human. They have divine power. Power to destroy strongholds. Before I take my seat, I was reminded of how powerful this love can be, and how powerful and important it is to pray for those who not only don't like you, but who would rather see you dead, or who want to take your place. Just a couple weeks ago,
Actually, just a couple days ago, I went to an elementary school and I read a book about Ruby Bridges to the children in the classroom. And y'all may not remember her by name, but Ruby Bridges was the six-year-old girl who integrated the schools in New Orleans. You may remember, if you're older like I am, that there was an old painting by Norman Rockwell of Ruby walking into the schoolhouse with her fresh pressed bows and her clean dress, but with militia all around her. And when Ruby did that brave thing, this six-year-old girl had to walk past crowds of angry white folk who didn't want her in their school. This six-year-old girl had to walk past a woman who every day told her, "I'm gonna find a way to kill you. Trust me, I will." This six-year-old girl had to walk past that angry crowd of white folks, and somebody even had a coffin with a little baby girl in it, a little black doll. And yet this six-year-old girl kept on walking. And what I see in that story, y'all, we can keep on walking. We may not have militia around us, but hallelujah, somebody, we've got grace and we've got mercy walking with us, because the word of God says, "They shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Well, Ruby kept on walking, and she kept on walking, but one morning, Ruby stopped. And her lips started moving. She stopped, and her lips started moving. And her teacher, sitting up in the classroom that was empty, and the teacher who was waiting for Ruby looked out and said, "What's happening?" Because normally Ruby would just walk on through, but this morning Ruby stopped, and her lips were moving. When Ruby got to the classroom, the teacher said, "What happened, Ruby? Why did you stop? And why were you talking to the people?" Ruby got indignant. "I wasn't talking to the people. I was praying for them." You better hear me this morning. A six-year-old who was the daughter of a Methodist minister. Every morning it was her custom, because her parents taught her what the word says, that Jesus says, "Pray for your enemies." And every morning before she went to school, this six-year-old prayed for her enemies. That's how she could walk on through the crowd. And every night before she went to bed, this six-year-old pioneer, freedom fighter, prayed for her enemies. That's why she could walk on through. But that particular morning she had forgotten to pray. So instead of addressing the people who were spewing all the hate at her, she looked up to the hills from whence cometh her help. Because even as a six-year-old, she knew that all her help comes from the Lord. And she prayed for those who were abusing her. She prayed for those who wanted her dead. She prayed for those who didn't think she was human. Now I just want to ask somebody in the house, is there anybody here who has faith like that six-year-old? Is there anybody in the house who will stand on your feet this morning and say, "I'm gonna do no hate, but I'm gonna love my enemies. I'm gonna do no hate, but I'm gonna pray for my enemies. I'm gonna do no hate, but I'm gonna pray for my enemies. God, help me. Help me pray for my enemies, because my Savior showed me best when he stood on that old rugged cross. My Savior demonstrated the love of giving myself and putting myself in harm's way for the betterment of those around me and for the love of even my enemy. And what did Jesus say when they had nailed him to the cross? What did Jesus say when they had nailed him to the old rugged cross? While they jeered him, what did he say? forgive them, for they know not what they do. What would happen if we looked at the TV and that man was saying all that stuff, and we started to pray for him, Father, forgive him. Father, even while I'm still struggling, you forgive him. What would happen if we went into that meeting and we know they're gonna act a fool, but we said, Father, forgive them. What would happen if we went into even the church house and we know somebody might say something, but we said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Come on, everybody standing. No hate, no hate, no hate. We got to know who we are. Did you hear what I said about Ruby? She already knew who she was. It didn't matter. At 6 years old, she already knew who she was. And she changed the atmosphere. Not long after, a couple little white kids came to school, and then a few more and a few more. And all of a sudden, the entire community was transformed because we love our enemies. Now, this kind of love is available only to those who are filled with the divine spirit of God. You can't fake this love. Come on, somebody. You might be able to hold your rein, hold your mule for the first 99 times, but if you're gonna really love like this, you got to have Jesus all up in you. Hallelujah, somebody. So I feel like the time is long spent, but we have to just invite you to come and share in this love. Won't you come? Somebody needs to come and share in this love. If you're worshiping virtually, just fill out the form there and we will receive you. The doors of the